The Stranger at the Door, a drama. Graham Woodley and Leonard Woodley, the two brothers in their late 20s. Lance Stirling, a mysterious cousin, bearded and bespectacled. The scene is a lonely house on the moors, overgrown with creepers. Graham and Leonard Woodley are playing backgammon in the lounge.
Just what I needed, a double six.
It's been so lonely out here since Mother passed away.
We're lucky to have Rover for company anyway. Things could be worse. I must say that this backgammon every night does get tiresome after a while. Perhaps we should send for a Monopoly set.
That wind howling outside is making me feel uneasy. As if something is about to happen. Something strange and unexpected. You know what they say, Leonard. When an ill wind blows through the moors on a stormy night, dark spirits are abroad.
Well, as long as they're not around here.
Don't be a fool.
I was only trying to cheer you up. You've upset Rover now.
I think there's someone outside. I better go and have a look. Good evening. What can we do for you?
I thought you might not recognize me, Leonard. After all these years, you were only 12 years old when I left.
Lord Stirling! We thought you'd been killed in Africa. This is unbelievable.
It's a long story, and one which I'd prefer to forget. I had to come back to see the old place again.
You've changed, Lance.
I've done a lot of things in the last 15 years, Graham, and I haven't enjoyed all of them. In fact, sometimes I think I've seen too much. I chose a different path in life to you right from the start. Always the black sheep of the family with the wrong ideas.
Graham and I always did our best to make you feel at home, Lance. We were only boys, and it was difficult with Father being ill.
We were amazed when the solicitors told us about the will and the £100,000. Without it, we could never have started on the nursery.
Oh, I knew the stories that have been going on around about me, and I can appreciate what it must have been like for the two of you to put up with the embarrassment of people talking in hushed tones, constantly being the subject of malicious gossip. A sort of petty bigotry that gradually wears away at the outer fabric of a man's self-esteem and strains at the breaking point of your utmost boundary of control. The type of person to fear is the yellow-bellied, cowardly, quivering, cur-like villain who spreads a thick, malodorous layer of untruths in your smoldering wake of injustice. Even your best friends can turn snake-like upon you and tear at the once iron-bound fabrics of a forgotten moment. A face at the window. But you wouldn't understand this. You, who have always sheltered from the snarling wolves of a twisted society. If it's possible, I'd like to stay with you for a few days because I have a few things to do in town. And if my old room is still empty, I would like to use it.
We're using it for the dahlia bulbs.
Oh, well, I have a tent which I can pitch outside if necessary.
I wondered what that was in that rucksack on your back.
Enough of this idiotic banter. I've never trusted you, Lance. Not since you used to steal my matchbox cars all those years ago. It's time for the truth to come out. Get that dog out of here, Leonard. It's messing on the carpets.
Oh, Jesus.
You have to decide, Lance. Either confess all or be turned away by your own kind to be thrown at the mercy of the howling winds. The hideous moaning of the marsh owls. Where no man walks without the nameless dread at his heels, from which there is no escape.
Hang on. Let's not get too excited about this. How about a nice cup of tea and we can all watch the television for a while?
Okay.
All right?
Oh, Jesus, I don't like this program very much.
Well, before we go on,
I watched it on Wednesday last
viewers,
week. It was terribly weak. Let's switch it off.
Very well, then. Let's try the other station.
And here is the regional news read by Limpy Besson. Today in Karasta.
Oh, no. What a heavy old fruit.
Well, thanks for the tea. I think I'll go outside and pitch the tent. I'm feeling pretty tired out. See you in the morning, then.
Cheerio.
See you, guys.
Cheerio.
Jeepers.
I don't like this, Leonard. There's something fishy about that Lance Sterling. We've got to uncover the secrets of his dark past.
It is a fine sunny day. The birds are singing as Lance slumbers on inside his Weather King pup tent. The Woodley brothers approach stealthily.
Let's have a look inside that huge rucksack he carries on his back. Careful not to wake him.
Right.
The life handbook of photography. What could this mean? Socks. Underpants. A Kodak Instamatic. The Jimmy Dorsey saxophone tutor. I can't make head or tail of this, Graham.
Well, let's spin a coin and decide.
Don't be an idiot. Shh. He's waking up.
What's going on?
We were just checking to see if you were all right.
I just wondered. It seems a bit strange that you're looking in my rucksack. If only I could just exist without people always trying to uncover the secrets of my dark past. I think I'll go and do a bit of practice.
What's that horrible sound? It's coming from Lance's tent. I'll go and have a look. Good God. He's playing a horrible looking dirty old alto saxophone.
That's right. And what's more, a couple of the pads are worn and it leaks too. Perhaps the two of you have got something against my playing.
I never knew you were so talented. I just like the saxophone.
A few days have passed. A certain amount of tension has built up between Lance Sterling and the Woodley brothers. One evening we find Leonard and Graham in the dusty attic of the rambling old family house.
The family archives are in here, Graham. I still feel that you're being a bit over-suspicious of him, you know.
I'm just being cautious. You must have asked yourself the question, is he the real Lance Sterling? There must be something in here that will give us some concisive proof of his identity.
Let's see, the late Reginald Woodley. Good Lord, look at this! A document from Hargreaves, Hargreaves and Smetherington, father's old firm of solicitors.
To my ward, Lance Sterling, I bequeath a third part of my estate. The other two parts are to be divided equally, of course, among my two sons, Leonard and Graham. They, however, are not to know of this until such time as Lance may return to this country. Lance is identifiable by a pear-shaped birthmark on the tip of his dear young member. The birthmark is on the underside of the member and therefore not readily visible upon a casual glance. I pronounce this to be my last will and testament. Reginald Woodley, fledgling of the Knights of Columbus.
You know what this means, don't you?
I'm not doing it.
There's a lot of money involved, you know.
Do you think I'm going to ask whether or not I can have a look at his member?
It's the only way that we can be sure he really is Lance Sterling.
Perhaps we can catch him in the bath.
And lift his penis up. Don't be an imbecile. I think I have the answer. I must go off to the village for a while. I've got what we need. This is a powerful brand of sleeping pill I got from Mr. Thropp. Mandrops or something. Three of these powdered in a drink before his bath will put him out all right.
You always were a good thinker, Leonard.
Lance Stirling, later that same evening, is about to take his bath.
Another tot of scotch and a drink, Lance.
No, it's all right. I must go and bath.
Please, I insist.
Yes, don't be a wet blanket, Lance.
Oh, all right then.
I've done it. Now at last we'll know the truth. He's fast asleep. I can see through the keyhole. Right, let's go in. Good heavens, I had no idea.
They say it's not really size that counts.
Well, go ahead.
I suppose you refuse.
Right.
Well, it's just like a piece of steak, I suppose. Here goes. There it is. It's shaped like a bear.
What the hell do you think you're doing?
There was a wasp circling on you. Sorry to disturb you. See you for dinner.
Fruit. I suspected it. I've got to get out of here.
The truffles are very good.
I prepared them myself. Lance, there's something we should have a talk about.
Oh, really?
Do you think we could all meet in the smoking room after dinner, say about 8:30?
Very well.
Plants, these.
They're a type of wide-spreading weed in certain areas.
It's time you told us the truth, Lance. The whole truth.
Had enough of all these pleasantries. Don't you think I'm also tired of this never-ending circle of falsehood? All right. I'm past caring. You might as well know the truth.
It was 10 years ago in the Congo. As you know, I went to seek my fortune as a mercenary. I ran into some difficulty when I attacked a wild lion in the bush one day and found myself lying in a crude native hut after being unconscious for 6 weeks.
Sounds like a fight for business. Yes.
I was taken in by a group of wandering Maasai tribesmen. I soon picked up the language, having a natural flair for words, and before long, I was taking part in the local activities. One night, the tribe gathered to listen to some music played by the tribal musicians, and I went along out of interest. I became friendly with the wizened old tribesman who played the saxophone. He apparently had been taught by a Jesuit monk who played a bit. Eventually, he made me a present of his ancient saxophone, and I left the tribe looking for work in other parts of the jungle. I eventually got the second alto chair with the Egimapele big band, which was quite popular at that time. We did trading posts mostly, but the river gigs were the most fun. Anyway, I had been with the Mapele band for 7 years when I discovered a letter from old Hargreaves and them, explaining the position with the inheritance. I was blowing up a storm at the time, so the money didn't really interest me. All my life, I've brought unhappiness wherever I've gone.
This has always been your problem, Lance.
And finally, I had found a secure place where I could be of some use to my fellow man. But then, the big bands were dying out in the jungle. It was the smaller trios and the quartets that were getting all the work. Tension was running high in the band until one day Mapele disappeared with all the bread.
What?
All the band's earnings for the month, plus
the band fund, which amounted to about 200 head of cattle. I vowed to track him down. It's been 2 long years, but a man can't hide 200 big ox-like creatures that easily.
You thought you'd perhaps find him here, well, I can assure you...
No, you idiot. I came for my rightful share of the money, so I can continue my search for Eglimond Mapele, known as Eggy Mapele. Now you know, I've told you everything.
I don't know what to say.
You mean we owe you £33,333.33 recurring?
Exactly.
You're a ghost from the past, Lance. A forgotten memory. A man with no name. And now, suddenly you emerge from the grave without warning to tax us with your cruel demands, your merciless hunger for riches, your insatiable lust for material gain.
Well, it's my money.
You always had an answer for everything. Get that animal out of here. It's peeing on the carpet again.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, listen, I've had enough of this. Good night, gentlemen.
You know what this means, don't you, Graham? We're going to have to do away with Lance Sterling.
No! I won't be part of this. You're a gutless fool. Do you realize we'd have to sell the nursery to pay him all that money? This is the only way.
How will we do it?
I have the perfect plan. I've considered this before. While Lance is engrossed in one of his evening practice sessions, you will stealthily approach and dispatch him with Father's old blunderbuss. The noise won't be noticed tomorrow night because there'll be a band playing at the town hall.
All right. I'll do it. But don't ever ask me anything like this again.
Good. Tomorrow night, then.
Lance is hard at work practicing. Graham Woodley approaches, armed with an ancient muzzle-loading device.
I can't go through with it. He's within range. 10 feet. I suppose it's now or never.
So! I suspected as much. Put that gun down, Graham, before I bring the power of fists into play.
It was only a joke, Lance. It wasn't loaded. Oops. How silly of me.
Now get out of here and leave me in peace. I'll see you for tea at 5.
You failed, you idiot. What are we going to do now?
But wait. I see Lance's bags are packed on the porch outside. It looks as if he's moving out.
Friends, I am leaving this evening. I have decided that money is not important to me.
That the pursuit of worldly gain is but a shallow enterprise. Only in my music can I find true happiness, unmarred by the vicious tensions of the commercial world. I am going back to darkest Africa to join up with Eggy Mapele's new trio, as he wants to go into a quartet now. As my old mentor calls, I must go. All I ask of you is enough to pay my fare.
Is this goodbye, Lance?
Yes.
I'll write you out a check.
I want to leave right now.
All right, here it is. Will this be enough?
Yes, thank you.
Goodbye, Lance.
Goodbye.
Drop us a postcard sometime. He's gone.
He was a good man. If only he could have stayed.
No. Lance must move on. He knows that the future lies only ahead for him.
And so, Lance Sterling walks off into the sunset, alto saxophone under his arm. A man who knows that wherever he goes, he brings unhappiness. His home is the road. will he be forever a stranger at the door? The Stranger at the Door was recorded at 213 Studios, Southwest Africa.